without wasting much time, we can go for the presentation. Will you load my presentation? Thank you. Not getting full screen here. Thank you. So in the next 15 minutes, I shall try to complete this, adding a new dimension to the diagnosis and management of NAFLD. Although my dear friend Ashish wanted to speak on this topic, but I really did not snatch. Later on, I have been made for this for some reasons. HDLs have low insulin sensitivity as compared to our European counterpart, so that's why we are having a high incidence of insulin resistance and high prevalence of insulin resistance, almost 35% in the young age. And this is a very good example that YY paradox for the high insulin resistance in Indian people having the similar BMI, but despite that, 3 times higher fat body content. And this is the story of all evils which remains there. So when we talk about this insulin resistance and various metabolic conditions, we see type 2 diabetes, everybody knows about that. This is the maximum people are having in our country out of all the problems which are because of the insulin resistance, then atherogenic diabetic dyslipidemia, and of course the NAFLD, which is suffering with 32% population. So residual cardiovascular diabetes risk is the thing which always takes the attention of all of us, especially the patient, those who are being treated with the statin. We have seen in the HPS trial as well as the CARDS trial that either you treat with the simvastatin or you treat with the atorvastatin, a certain amount of the population will still remain on the risk, then that is called the residual risk. Despite taking the simvastatin regularly in prescribed doses, 22% risk reduction takes place in 78%. People still remain with the residual risk of the cardiovascular disease. On the other hand, people, those who are taking the atorvastatin, 68% remains with the residual cardiovascular disease risk. So atherogenic dyslipidemia is found to be a culprit which is associated with 44% higher risk of cardiovascular adverse outcome. So of course, it is not only the LDL cholesterol which is causing difficulties and adverse cardiovascular outcomes in Indian population, but it is also the high triglyceride and low HDL which is playing a bigger role than cholesterol only. And we can say that atherogenic diabetic dyslipidemia, which is found in India, is constituted by all the three: high TG, low HDL, and LDL cholesterol high. So critical importance of the high TG reduction is endorsed by the international guidelines. Either you go with the European Society of Cardiology or you go with the ACE guidelines. All says in high-risk patient with triglyceride level between 135 to 499 milligram per deciliter, despite a statin treatment, you can add N3, PUPA, icosapentaenoic acid in a day, and at the same time, it should be considered in combination with a statin. And now we can really think about some drug which can reduce this high triglyceride level. So what is that which can make us thinking about, which can be added in place of new molecules, that is saroglitazar is a dual PPAR alpha and gamma agonist. And it is first NCE of India from any Indian pharmaceutical organization which has been accepted across the world. And it has been earlier meant for the atherogenic diabetic dyslipidemia. Mechanism of action, I'm not going in detail of that, but you know it well. It is acting on alpha as well as gamma PPAR agonism. So as far as the integrated review analysis is concerned, we have the 18 clinical studies of the saroglitazar, which has shown the positive results of not only reduction of the triglyceride, but also reduction in the HbA1c and liver enzymes too. So one question arises in mind, should high triglyceride be considered as cardiovascular risk factor? And at what triglyceride level do you prefer to use saroglitazar in type 2 diabetes patients? When we talk about this relation of the insulin resistance with various metabolic conditions, it comes in our mind that is the NAFLD, which is caused by insulin resistance, and 32% Indians are suffering. This is the neglected epidemic. Very few people know about that. A normal liver, when people don't go for the exercise, when people are keep on eating the carbohydrate rich diet, they start having the deposition of the fat in their liver. And this steatosis later on gets converted into the steatohepatitis with the inflammation, and later on with fibrosis. After that, it develops into cirrhosis. So earlier we can see the worldwide prevalence of the steatosis in 25%, which ends up with the cirrhosis in 0.5 to 2.6% of the patient. Insulin resistance is one of the root cause for this adverse condition, which can be diagnosed in people more than 5% steatosis in hepatocytes confirmed by the biopsy or imaging method. Insulin resistance is one of the supporting evidence. No other secondary causes of the steatosis is there. Then again, it gives an idea it may be because of the metabolic reason or a high IR. Alcohol consumption threshold have been shown to the for men up to 30 gram in a day, in women for up to 20 gram in a day. Up to, and if it is being consumed more than this, then alcohol may also be one of the factors for the NAFLD. So when we talk about the comorbidities, who are at the high risk people, those who are having overall prevalence of NAFLD in India up to 32%, they are the people with NAFLD going to have comorbidities, type 2 diabetes, obesity, dyslipidemia, hypertension, and one of the biggest one is the polycystic ovarian syndrome, which is seen exclusively in women, but it is quite dreaded and with a lot of adverse events, metabolic adverse events. So prevalence of the NAFLD in obesity is 80%, normal population it is 32%, type 2 diabetes is 70-80%, and 50% are progressed to advanced fibrosis. So for odds ratio, if we compare with the diabetes with without diabetes, we see that 1.76 for the NASH and 2.57 for the cirrhosis. Real world data reveals a huge diagnostic gap in NAFLD. Estimated global prevalence is up to 25-30% at this, increasing in comorbid conditions like diabetes and obesity, but incidence rate is very low. What does it mean? It means that we are really not picking up the cases. That's why the incidence rate is very low, but the prevalence is quite high. So is another question comes in our mind, is NAFLD an underestimated complications of metabolic disease like diabetes, obesity, and dyslipidemia? Diabetes, obesity, and dyslipidemia are gathering a lot of focus of all of us from all the specialties, may it be endocrinologists, may it be gastroenterologists, may it be cardiologists. But NAFLD is really being underestimated. Earlier, only the gastroenterologists were talking about. Now few endocrinologists have started talking about that. But it is also in the roots of cardiovascular adverse outcomes too. So when we talk about the clinical presentation, screening is the most important step because we are failing at that point only. Most of the patients are asymptomatic. So that's why it should be reviewed annually in all patients of the diabetes, hypertension, as well as hyperlipidemia. Medical insurance, occupational health checks are usually grabbing the patient when they are getting checked, their various parameters. 17% of the patients with type 2 diabetes have significant fibrosis when assessed by the non-invasive imaging tool. And ADA has suggested that NASH and fibrosis screening should be recommended in person with type 2 diabetes or pre-diabetes and elevated liver enzymes level of ALT or fatty liver. Evaluation and management of the NAFLD in patients with type 2 diabetes is really call to action when a patient is suffering with pre-diabetes. Usually we try to catch them early. If the patient is suffering with pre-diabetes, high insulin resistance, obesity, we should try to get his liver enzymes level. If the liver enzymes level is abnormal, definitely we should go for the assessment of the fibrosis by MR elastography, transient elastography, or fibrosis biomarker panel. If we find advanced fibrosis, of course, the lifestyle management is the mainstay of the treatment. Then we should also think about the drug treatment and also consider the liver biopsy. But if it is indeterminate, the liver biopsy can only give the answer whether it is definite NASH or no NASH. If it is there is no advanced fibrosis, we should keep on doing the periodic evaluation as a standard of the care. AST-ALT ratio, the HGPT-SGOT ratio, does not really rule out the NASH. Liver enzymes may be normal in 80% of the NAFLD patient. ALT-AST not sensitive for the NAFLD and NASH. There is a poor correlation between ALT and the histology. Typically decreases with the advanced fibrosis. SGPT typically decreases with the advanced fibrosis. As NASH progresses, this ratio may increase. So histology severity is similar in NAFLD patient with normal when it is compared with the abnormal liver enzyme. So many of the times it is not really a true marker. But how can we really find the patient with the advanced fibrosis in NAFLD? Of course, there is NAFLD fibrosis score, where we are having the two different score. One is the NAFLD fibrosis score and the FIB-4 score. And the low cutoff is there. If the people are having the low probability out of the four, there are the three are normal, and the high cutoff when the three are found to be positive and the out of four. FibroScan is another method to which the vibration control transient elastography can check about the fibrosis. It is directly related to the tissue stiffness, and stiffer the liver, the faster the shear wave propagates and most reliable in ruling out the advanced hepatic fibrosis. When we talk about the liver biopsy, the confirmative test, this is that, and of course the benefits are there with few limitations, the risk of bleeding, sampling variability, sometimes inter-individual variability there. But this is the gold standard for knowing about the fibrosis of the liver. Another question comes up that as per the clinical experience, what should we consider for NAFLD screening and how to confirm diagnosis of it? Lifestyle modification is the key approach for NAFLD management. I don't think there can be any doubt in anybody's mind. Weight loss works very well when, as far as the reduction in NAFLD is concerned. When we talk about the pharmacological management, all drugs are used off-label medication, but there are few drugs which are being used more. Although we have the insufficient evidences in the favor of that, like metformin, vitamin E, UDCA, and obeticholic acid. Although few guidelines has also included the PPAR, gamma agonist, pioglitazone as a treatment for NAFLD in their guidelines, but it is also not. It is also not the universal. Most of the guidelines are including this and few of the guidelines are not really. But as far as I know, Indian Gastroenterology Association has accepted this pioglitazone as a treatment for NAFLD even in non-diabetic individuals. Saroglitazar is another option with the PPAR alpha gamma agonist. Treatment of NAFLD. As a treatment of NAFLD, there has been a lot of studies which has shown its which has proven it's worthy for the treatment of NAFLD. We can see that effectiveness of the PPAR agonist saroglitazar in non-alcoholic steatohepatitis. We are having a lot of positive data from preclinical and clinical studies with the inclusion and exclusion criteria could be the patient having the history of alcohol were not included, patient those who were having the type 2 diabetes treated with the agent other than metformin, sulfonylurea, DPP-4, they were not included, and obviously having the previous liver biopsy, they have not been included with type 1 diabetes also. So study endpoints in primary and secondary care, if we think about the proportion of the patient with decrease in non-alcoholic steatosis at week 52 by at least 2 points spread across at least two of the components, steatosis, hepatocyte, ballooning, and lobular inflammation with no worsening of the fibrosis. And these were the multiple secondary efficacy endpoints, percentage of the responders, change stage of steatosis, change in the stage of fibrosis, change in the area of fibrosis, liver enzymes level, change in the lipid profile, and of course the glycemic control and insulin resistance. Decrease in NAFLD activity scores more than 2 was observed in 52.3% of the patient without worsening of fibrosis at week 2 after using the saroglitazar. So saroglitazar has worked well in the reduction of the non-alcoholic steatosis as well as in the reduction of the liver parameters and of course in the reduction of the lipid parameters too. Mean percentage reduction of all secondary endpoints by Sarvatazar at week 52 has been seen significantly. You can see the almost all parameters are showing the significant p-value. So when we talk about the prospective observational real-world Indian data, we can see here 163 patient data, which is having the effectiveness of the Sarvatazar are important parameters for NAFLD as well as diabetic dyslipidemia, may it be liver enzymes, may it be triglyceride level, or of course, the other parameters, including the HbA1c, has also been found to be improved by using the Sarvatazar. It leads to significant improvement in transaminases, LSM, and CAP in NAFLD patients with TB. 2020 was the landmark year for the Sarvatazar, but when we could see that US FDA, when we could see that NASH approval by the DCGI, as well as in January 2021, US FDA has also approved it. So another question arises that can Sarvatazar be an effective option for the treating NAFLD? And after giving this much of the data, you have to decide whether it can be used for the NAFLD treatment or not. And still the trials are on and we are finding the answer, but available evidences say maybe it can be an option for the treatment of the NAFLD. Thank you.